Education Room. I'd like to thank everyone for coming. At this time, I'd like to call our meeting to order, and I would like to start with saying our pledge. So if we could all stand at this time.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all very much for that. I would like to remind everyone that by the entrance door, there's a place that you can sign in if you'd like to sign in. Mr. Saylor, do we have any revisions to our agenda?
No, we do not. It's been posted. The only thing was one item removed, but it was nothing that is going to impact the meeting.
Okay. At this time, item number two on our agenda is our recognitions, and we'd like to start with our Mountain Movers. Miss Abby Smith is our student representative, and I'd like to ask her to come forward and to share with everyone our Mountain Movers.
Our first Mountain Mover is our community Mountain Mover from the Silent Mill Gift Shop, Miss Gay Oliver, CPA. Gay Oliver, CPA opened in Estill County in 1986, and Silent Mill Gift Shop opened in 2001. They have been supporting district initiatives since that time. Those include modern woodman programs in schools, staff opening day sponsor and attendee, matching flow party funds, student coloring contests, flag sponsorship for schools, ECHS athletic sponsorship, and a senior trip sponsor.
Yeah, he's very sorry she couldn't be here tonight. It is our great honor as an office to participate in all of these things.
I'm going to present you with the Medal of Excellence, and then Abby will get a picture with you, and we'll try to get those posted to the website.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Our certified Mountain Mover is Mr. Jeremy Simpson. Jeremy began his career in the Estill County School District in 2009. From 2009 to 2015, he taught high school science, physics, chemistry, and forensics. In 2015, he became the district tech coordinator and chief information officer. Jeremy says that he enjoys working with school staff and students to improve and enhance all aspects of technology.
Jeremy is at the HISTI conference in Louisville with, I think, teachers, and we have students also down there, so we're very appreciative. In terms of equity, we always need to recognize at least one bald-headed student at least every year. So, that would be Jeremy, and I'm going to do it for this audience. But we really appreciate Jeremy. I couldn't even begin to tell you all the changes that we've made in the last 7 years, not only instructionally, in terms of the one-to-one devices for all students K through 12. That was a big undertaking. Interactive display boards in all classrooms, which is a brand new project that's just been done. I mean, I could go on, and our employees now, everything is automated, everything's online. We no longer print checks, we no longer do any of those things. Everybody has their own logins and everything, so. That's all because of Jeremy, and I would also say Andrew, who works with Jeremy. So thank you all.
Our classified Mountain Mover is Ms. Cindy Lass. Cindy is a lunchroom monitor at Estill Springs and has been in that position for 3 years. Cindy started at Estill Springs as a lunchroom volunteer when her granddaughter attended school there and was offered a position shortly thereafter. Prior to working at Estill Springs, Cindy was a nurse at the Children's Clinic for 18 years. Cindy says that the Estill Springs family is great to work with and that she loves all the kids.
Cindy, I'll give you a medal and then we can get a picture. But thank you so much for what you do for our kids.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There you go. agenda, we have South Irvine Early Learning Center. We have some presentations from the students here this evening, and this is a highlight for our board. So we're super excited that you're here from South Irvine to share with us.
Well, I'll start, but I'm not going to take very much time because we brought the most precious things with us from South Irvine. That's these children and the adults. But I do want you to know, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about South Irvine. We have 9 2-year-old students there at South Irvine. We serve 54 3-year-old students, and we serve 109 4-year-old students. We also have 16 early Head Start students, so that is birth to 3 there at South Irvine. So in total, we serve at South Irvine 188 children. And we are able to take all 4-year-old children that want to come at this point. So that's because of basically you guys valuing early childhood education. So thank you for that. And on behalf of all of us there, we thank you for that, because that's how we're able to do these things that you're about to see. I also want to say that we are in partnership with Head Start through Community Action Council. We share 100 students. So 100 of our students are also Head Start students. So we've been able to do some amazing things because of that. Mr. Willis, you probably have a video back there of the gross motor room. That's something that we recently installed starting this year. And I just want you to see a glimpse inside of it if you haven't yet. And that's only because of our Head Start partnership we've been able to do that. Going to work on pulling it up? There it is. That might be their favorite place. So Head Start helped us with that, and most recently we also have a partnership with Berea Regional Training Center. They support our preschool, and we have recently received a $35,000 grant for a sensory room. So it will be something similar to this, only a calming room instead. We spend a lot of time with social emotional learning at South Irvine in preschool, but we do take time for reading and math and science and social studies. Ms. Emily Johnson is going to come up and share with you a little bit about math, and then we have a math video to share. We don't stand in front of big people very often. We're all a little nervous.
Thank you.
for heavier and lighter. As far as instruction, we do math instruction as guided instruction through whole group and small group, and we also learn math through our centers. Our center time is different than other school center time. Centers for our students is learning through play. This is so important because it takes less repetitions for synapses to occur during play. Some of our centers are manipulatives, music, science, art, reading, kitchen, and blocks. These centers give students an opportunity to use, explore, and expand on what we are learning in each unit. The centers change with each unit with things that relate to that unit. The lead teachers at South Irvin work collaboratively to pair the early childhood standards to our creative curriculum. We try to pair math standards that we think would work best with each unit as we navigate through the year. Then we come together and discuss if that was a fitting standard for that unit, if it should be moved, or if we need to leave it where it is. Assessments are also made collaboratively among the lead teachers. We read the standards and examples within the early childhood standards to create assessments that are appropriate for the students and align with the standards. We then come back together after the unit to look at our data and discuss any issues we noticed with these assessments. For example, when assessing heavy and light last year, my own students counted the number of bears on each side instead of just telling me which was heavy or light. So they're really telling me which one had more, not which one was heavier. So we talked about the assessment. And that's
we have a math video to show you.
Yes, Emily. You're doing a very good job, Ms. Johnson.
So this has our children in it, and if you are on the side, you may not be able to see. It's going to be on this TV and this one. If the kids want to come up or any adults want to come up,
they
can
come up
too.
And sit crisscross applesauce
right
if they want up front.
Whoa. Your cord's running out.
Thank you. Exactly. about what?
Driving the bus.
Driving the bus, because guess what the pigeon wants to do? Oh, look, you told me about this guy. Who is this guy?
A bus driver.
Oh, and wait, the bus driver is going to give you some directions. Are you ready? It says, hi, I'm the bus driver. Listen, I've got to leave for a little while, so can you watch things for me until I get back? Do you think you can do that?
Yeah.
Can you watch things? And it says, thanks. Oh, and remember, don't let the pigeon drive the bus. What are we supposed to do?
Don't let the pigeon drive the bus.
Yeah, don't let the pigeon drive the bus. I'm going to open it up to the next page. Oh, look, there's the bus driver. What's he doing?
He's walking away.
What was that?
A pigeon.
Did you see him?
Yeah.
He's sneaking in. What did those words say? Actually, those words say for Cheryl. So whoever wrote this book, they wanted to dedicate it to someone named Cheryl. Look, there he is.
Oh, no.
He's doing the book. I think he's probably right. Do you want to know what he said?
I want the bus coming.
Oh, you think so? Okay, let me tell you what he said. Here's what he said. He said, I thought he'd never leave. Oh, no. There's the pigeon.
Two pigeons.
Well, actually, it's the same pigeon. This is on one page, and this is on a second page. It's the same pigeon. So here's the pigeon thinking, and the pigeon says, hey.
Oh, boy.
Can I drop a bus?
Are you going to let him have the bus?
No!
Oh, look. The pigeon says, please.
No!
Are you going to let the pigeon drop the bus?
No!
Oh, wait. You know what the pigeon says here? He says, I'll be careful.
No.
Are you going to let the pigeon drive the bus?
No.
Oh, wait. He's got an idea. I tell you what, I'll just steer.
No.
He's just going to use the steering wheel. Is that okay?
No.
Oh, he's got another idea. Listen to this. He says, my cousin Herb drives a bus almost every day.
No!
Are you going to let him drive the bus?
No!
He says, true story. Look at him right here. What's wrong?
Yeah.
He's sad. Why is he sad?
Because he can't drive the bus.
What else is he?
He's pouting.
He's what?
Pouting.
Because
he can't drive the bus.
Show me what you look like when you're sad. Says vroomy vroom vroom vroom. Pigeon at the wheel. Are you gonna let him drive the bus?
No.
He says no. Look at this page. What is he on this page?
Sad.
What else might he be?
Left out.
What else might he be? What is he? Frustrated. He's frustrated. Show me frustrated.
What did they say?
Show me frustrated. He says, wait a minute.
Wait.
Guess what he says?
What?
I bet you've said this before. I never get to do anything.
I have
said that before?
Yeah,
as a mom, I've heard that before. You want to know what he says now? He says, let's see if you're going to fall for this one. He says, hey, I've got an idea. Let's play drive the bus.
No!
He says, I'll go first.
No!
You are way too smart for him. He says, come on, just once around the block.
No!
Oh, my goodness. Wait till you see this page. He's going to pull out all the stops. Are you ready? I'll be your best friend. How about I give you $5? No fair. I bet your mom would let me drive the bus. What's the big deal? It's just a bus. I have dreams, you know.
Wait, that's the only one you have to drive. There's two more.
No, I read them all. I said them all. Oh, no. I'm going to tell you what it says on the next page. Are you ready? I'm going to tell you. you what it says, but then I want you to take a look at the next page. Are you ready? The next page says, let me drive the bus. I want you to look at the next page. Are you ready? Because it doesn't just say, let me drive the bus. It says, let me drive the bus. Look how big those words are. And what's at the end?
An exclamation point.
An exclamation point. Not only is there one, there is one, two, three exclamation points. He really wants to drive that bus. Are you going to let him drive the bus?
No!
Look at him. Show me frustrated again. Yeah, that's how the pigeon feels. Uh-oh. No, maybe we should. Do you want to know what happens?
Yeah.
Look who's back.
Oh.
I'm back. You didn't, wait, he's got a question for you. Are you ready? You didn't let the pigeon drive the bus, did you?
No.
Great, thanks. Where's the pigeon going? Yeah, he's out of there. He says,
uh-oh.
He did. He said, uh-oh. Bus driver says, bye.
Uh-oh. He's even about a shot.
Another bus?
A truck.
A truck?
Truck.
A truck? You want to see?
A tractor.
A tractor? Those are all very good answers. Yeah. Do you want to know what it is?
We're giving you a standing ovation.
What did you think about that?
I think we are finished. I do want to say that the talent you can tell of our grown-ups there at South Urban is very deep and wide also. They pull that off all day long, 5 days a week. Thank you guys for coming, and thank you adults for entrusting your children.
Well, Ms. Hall, we appreciate you and your staff, and I know what a huge job you all got, 188 little ones. I mean,
yes.
Our littlest, most precious kids that we have, and we're very thankful for the job you all do. We're very thankful for CAC, Community Action Council. They're a fantastic partner with our school district, and we're excited about that partnership continuing, and this is our future. It's going to be, 12, 13 years from now, they will be graduates of Estill County High School, so, and some of them. These all 4-year-olds?
No.
Oh,
not.
So we're talking about 18 years from now or 19 years from now. So we're really appreciative. And I'm adding a few more probably. We're talking about 13, 14, 15 years. So I don't know where I got 17, 18, 19. That's those math skills I used to have. Honestly, we do have students over there that are brand new babies. So they are 18 years away from being Estill County High School graduates. So thank you all for coming. And again, this is the highlight of our meeting. So thank you all.
And it's okay if they, if the parents' families leave, right?
Hey, Miss Margaret. She's Sheena's fourth grade teacher. Margaret.
She's my neighbor.
She's fourth grade teacher.
Yeah, she's my neighbor.
With her for many years.
I think Peter was running.
Yeah, he was.
Fight the current.
Now, Peter, you're hard act to follow.
I cannot imagine.
So, next on our agenda is our facilities and construction update. And first on our list, we have Estill Springs Elementary ESSER renovation and addition project.
Peter's handling everything tonight.
Yeah, we had a
he can do it. We have faith in him.
The update on Estill Springs, we had a great meeting there today, you guys. The project is on schedule for completion in June. A lot of work that's happened there this past month includes work on the storm lines. The masonry is all up on the building, which is great to see, and they're doing some in the Memorial Park as well. The roof board is on, so the building is dried in. Lights in the amphitheater have been put in, and that's great news as well. And the windows and doors are, I guess I saw all the windows in today, but the doors are still lacking there. Anticipated completion on almost everything before the end of school. There's a little bit of work going on after school is out, including some final storm drainage work, the canopy at the back of the building, and then epoxy flooring in the school. So I'll be happy to answer any questions that you guys have on that project. Very busy job site today.
I've been past it about 3 or 4 times this past week.
Well, I don't know if y'all have noticed or not, the monument's going up. Yep. Old brick that was salvaged looks really good.
It does look great.
They're doing a fantastic job with it, so it looks really fantastic. You all will love to know that we have encountered some sewer issues. So some
sanitary lines. Here we go again.
It does appear that it's going to be a pretty easy fix. You'll be getting a change order probably next board meeting. But there is funds within the project that will cover that. We honestly felt like it was going to be a lot more expensive than I think what we thought originally. It's going to be less than that. So I do feel like that we've got sufficient funds to handle that. And with that one, I think pretty much unless just something strange happens.
Don't talk about it.
We don't foresee another huge change order of any kind. June 1, I think, is substantial completion right now. Final will follow.
It's right there at the end of May. Yeah, right there. Yes, so.
We will have everything ready for our dedication on June 23rd. I think we're looking at like a 2 o'clock.
2 o'clock. Can we invite people?
Yes, it'll be open to the public. I've already communicated with the Urban High Alumni Association to let them know so that they can start making some plans as well. But I think they're going to be really pleased. Once everything is in, I think that the next administration will need to sort of work with Estill Springs. There is some playground equipment within that Memorial Park, but I don't know that it's going to be substantial enough for their upper-level kids. So we'll need to look at that, but there's plenty of room if there is additional play structures that need to go into that park. But looks really good. Excited about it.
So with all of that being said, we need consideration to approve a pay estimate number 6 for $496,770.89.
That's my recommendation. It's been reviewed.
So I need a motion to approve that. Do I have a motion by Sheila Samples? Do I have a second? Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? Not all in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries with a 4-0 vote. And I did not note for the meeting minutes that Brian Covey is out today, so he is out tonight. Okay, next on our agenda we have our Estill County High School Field Restroom Renovation Project, which is BG22-243.
So we had crews in the field this morning actually punching the final proposal request work that was done on the men's restroom and a lot of areas of flooring in both field house buildings. So we do anticipate to be here next month with our final payout for that project and the BG4. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have about that one as well.
Floors look fantastic. And of course, this was expanding the men's restroom that we were not able to get done before the season started. So looks really nice, and it's really the final part of the high school renovation, to be honest, unless you want to include the caboose that we're working on right now. But we're doing that as a maintenance project. This is really the last one. So as of just a couple punch list items, they're done.
Right.
So I need a motion for approval of pay application number 3 with DPO invoicing.
My recommendation that we approve that invoicing.
I have a motion by Sheila Samples. Do I have a second? Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries with a 4-0 vote. Next on our agenda, we have the West Irvin Pavement Improvement Project, which is BG22-178.
Yeah, so we're here this evening with closeout documents for this one. We finally were able to receive all of those from the contractor over in the last couple of weeks. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you guys have about West Irvin.
Parking lot does look fantastic. Mm-hmm. I know that they are going to come back just as soon as the weather breaks a little bit more into spring. They're going to overseed all the grass areas because when they hydroseeded this past fall, it was really dry for a long period of time. A lot of the grass is not coming up,
right.
So they're going to do that as part of the closeout on this document. He said, Mr. Wheeler, who's our president, told me that he would get us a date here so we can let Charlotte know when they'll be there, so you won't think there's a bunch of strangers outside. But glad to be able to close this one out and get the paperwork and everything done. Everybody's paid, and so it's my recommendation that we go ahead and close these documents out. So I guess we just need to take each one out.
So I need a motion to approve the final pay application number four?
Actually.
Let's do number two first, DPO and change orders on the final DPO reconciliation.
So I need a motion to approve the DPO change order and final DPO reconciliation. So we'll do that one first. So Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Do I have a second? Sheila Samples makes a second. Do we have any discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries with a 4-0 vote. Then I have the approval of the final pay app for number four.
Mm-hmm.
Have a motion for that. Sheila Samples makes a motion. Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? Like to call for a vote? All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries with a 4-0 vote. And then we have a motion for approval of BG4 for that same project.
Which is your closeout document with KPE, and then once we finalize some ESSER budget issues, which we pretty much got, we're on the downhill slide on that, we will get a BG5. We're going to bring to you probably in May and June, we'll be bringing you probably 10 BG5s on all these projects. We'll get them all closed out, get them reconciled, and that way the only thing that you're going to have hanging out there is going to be Estill Springs and possibly the district.
That'll be really close.
It'll be really close whether we can get that one done or not, the district safety and key and hardware project, but everything else should be done and closed out. So it's a recommendation to approve the BG4.
Do I have a motion to approve the BG4? Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Do I have a second? Sheila Samples makes a second. Any discussion? I'd like to call for a vote at this time. All in favor? Any opposed? The motion carries with a 4-0 vote. Item D on our agenda is the South Irvin renovation project, which is BG22-176.
So we're here with closeout documents for South Irvin as well. Jarbo was able to get us all of the necessary closeout documents for that project, which did wrap up. They were able to finish up the punch lists. Be happy to answer any questions that you guys have about South Irvin this evening.
I didn't know if you all noticed the video of the classroom there, but the new windows looks fantastic, and all the casework around the windows, and the new ceiling tile that tied that building into, tied everything together. That's a beautiful facility now that that project is complete, so they'll be serving these little tykes over there for the next 25 years in that building, so it's a beautiful place.
So I need a motion to approve the revised BG1.
I think it was just a little bit over in terms of the final cost, and there was some extra money within the printing of
yep.
the documents. So Peter just had to move some of the money from the printing to that. And there's not a lot of money left in the project after that. And of course, that's why Angie and I will close everything out. Those funds, since that's an ESSER project, they'll just go back into ESSER funds. So shouldn't be that big a deal, but KDE wants a BG1 that checks the dots the I's and crosses the T's, and that's what Peter's doing.
So I need a motion to approve the revised BG1. Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Sheila Samples makes a second. Do we have any discussions?
Carrie.
It don't matter.
I just saw hands going up, so it's been a long day.
I didn't
day.
See her. I always try to look.
So I need to call for a vote at this time. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries with a 4-0 vote. Next, I have I need a motion for approval of the final pay application number 9.
Recommendation is to do so.
Do I have a motion? Carrie Smallwood makes a motion and Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? If not, I need a call for a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries.
That was just a little bit below $58,000.
Yes, $57,963.
And then I have consideration to approve the BG4. Sheila Samples makes a motion. Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do I have any discussion? If not, I'd like to call for a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, that brings us down to item E on our agenda. It's the Estill County Safety and ADA Upgrades, which is BG23-087.
So we are still in the process of acquiring the materials for that. I think Mr. Haddix sent out an email last week indicating work occurring in mid-April and early May, I think, on that project to get all of this hardware installed. I do think it will go really quickly once they have the materials in hand. And that is, other than being here for change order that is related to some additional hardware this evening. That is the update on that particular project.
And I think we're ready to go with everything there. All the change orders have been sort of already taken care of. So as soon as the hardware arrives, they'll, you know, it'll take them, once they've installed a few doors at the middle school, they'll go quick after that.
I think it will go really
quick. And we've got a phasing plan at the middle school to take care of that. We've already worked with Ms. Napier, and then, of course, there'll be some Fridays. There won't be very many days they'll need at South Urban, but there are some Fridays that kids do not attend. They really feel like they can get those done. And then, of course, with the final day of school being May 17th, I think, right now, or 18th, maybe is closing day. So, and matter of fact, the preschool program is going to close on the 12th on that Friday, I believe, is what we've discussed with Ms. Hall. So they'll have plenty of time to get it done. I think there's a good chance we'll have closeout documents to you at the June board meeting. And you may have to reconcile the BG5, but we'll get it done.
So I need a motion to approve change order number 2. It says additional owner requested hardware on 3 doors at South Urban. So I need a motion to approve that change.
And it's $826.50, so.
It's worth every penny for those precious jobs.
And so Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Sheila Samples makes a second. Do we have any discussion? If not, I'd like to call for a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. So that brings us down to the high school HVAC controls project, which is item F on our agenda, and that's BG number 22-177.
Yeah, so I was real hopeful that I could be here with the closeout documents for that one this evening as well. The contractor was able to get the owner training done here over the last, I guess it was a week, 10 days ago. I can only assume that maybe they're having some difficulty acquiring just their closeout documents from their bonding company. Sometimes that takes a little bit of time, and controls guys don't typically GC a project, right? They don't have to usually bond for a project. So that, I'm assuming that's what's going on there. I do anticipate we'll be here next month with closeout documents for that. All the work is done. All the owner training is done. We're just lacking a few pieces of paper to sort of get this one closed out.
It should be, Peter, just one pay app and
it's one, it, I would assume a pay app and BG4. The pay app comes with several documents about having paid everybody and all of the people that work on the project, and I'm assuming that's what they're waiting to get.
Us to get.
Next on our agenda is item G. Mr. Sutter, do you want to talk about that, or is that
I'll
Peter?
I'll let Peter take it. It's part of the district facility planning process, and it's the work that we contracted with them to complete, which is just a survey of all of our school facilities.
Yeah, so we did. We have gotten into all of the facilities. There was a lot to do. You all were a really busy board over the last 4 years, so updating the K-Fix database in Frankfurt is taking a while, but we do have our architectural audits done. I think KFI is finishing up the MEP audits, and we anticipate providing a full report to the LPC committee here at the end of this month, and then you all will be hearing from the LPC meeting, those guys at your board meetings, probably in April. and again in May as we sort of finish up this process. I don't have anything more specific to tell you guys. I was, Jonathan was still working on the audits within KFIX, but I'm quite sure that you all will have a good district facility plan in about a month. So
I know that Stephen will communicate. I think there's a calendar that he's about ready to finish, and as soon as that calendar is complete, we'll shoot a copy to you guys so you'll know and sort of keep you up to date to when the meetings are. We did receive one important piece of information that we've been waiting on a while. As you know, we had structural engineers that did a survey of Estill County Middle School. As everyone knows, when you look at that facility and you look up there on that hill, it's a beautiful facility, and you sit on the outside of that facility and you look at it, and there's not a brick crack, there's not a block crack, there's nothing that indicates that there's issues until you move inside of the building. And because at the time, the pyritic shell that we've had to spend a lot of money on to make sure that the ATC and the high school didn't have issues, really an unknown condition when that building was built. So there has been, since day one, since 1995-96, there has been issues in that building. I did get a report this week that that building is safe for student occupancy. And I was told that was the case from day one, but now we do have it in writing from a structural engineering firm in Lexington who is independent of Ross Tarrant and independent of our structural engineer that we've used on our other projects. But in talking to him, I believe that it's going to have a big impact on your district facility plan, because if you're going to put money into that building into the future, for instance, it's due right now a total HVAC renovation. It's at almost its 30-year stage in life. We're going to have to do a little work, because the thought is that building is not going to stop moving. It's going to continue to move. The floor slabs are going to continue to heave. There's going to be problems with the walls. And this is not for sure, it's not definite at this point, but within KDE, there is stipulations that if the cost repair of a building exceeds 80% of the replacement cost of that building, then they will not allow you to spend any further funding on that building. We believe that it's pretty close, because it would require extensive renovations to remove slabs, to replace slabs, to remove interior walls, to fix interior walls. Not only to include that, where are you going to have school during that time? Because that's not going to be a summer project. So I do think there is some exploration. I do know that the engineering, just the engineering fee for that is probably somewhere in the range of $10,000 to $12,000. That also means that you're going to have a contractor that's going to have to open up to where they can get inside of the crawl spaces to look at that building. But it's probably, my guess, as I've told you all before in previous board meetings, probably sometime in the mid-2030s, you're going to have to build a middle school, or this board is going to have to build a middle school to replace our current middle school. So, and that'll be at about the right time, because that's when all your bonds start paying off. So you're going to have bonding potential in order to do that. That's why you do the things that we do and plan ahead of time. So that could have a huge impact as we move forward on our district facility plan. And then, of course, based on how you classify that building, then we may be eligible for some urgent needs funding, because that is a building that will need to be replaced. It's due to unforeseen conditions. And there is money within KDE budgets to allow for urgent needs monies to help pay for that facility replacement. So I wanted to let you all know that tonight. You're going to hear that as you go through the DFP process. I think we have to approve the DFP by the May meeting so it can be on the June 1.
I think, so KBE is not a part of the process now that you all have elected to do House Bill 678.
So we would still submit it to...
So KBE will approve it in May and inform KBE that it's approved.
Yeah, okay. So we'll get that done, and that'll be one other thing that's off the new administration plate, okay?
So there's no action that's required on that. It's just a report. So I think that's it for you, Peter.
Thank you all.
Have a good evening. Thank you.
Be careful.
Careful, I'll be right behind you here in a little bit. That's what I did to Rowan that night.
Cheer for the Yellow Jackets now. Okay. Haven't been there in a really long time.
The Woodford Day looked good the other day.
We'll see you.
Next, it brings us down to some action items. We have first Estill County School versus the Jewel Labs Incorporated.
Ron Johnson, our attorney, on the action against Jewel Labs, overbooked tonight. Jonathan is on standby if we do need him. But Jewel Labs has agreed to a settlement, and there's hundreds of school districts that was part of this settlement. And so far, based on what has happened, every school district to this point has accepted the settlement for this particular issue. As you all know, vaping is a huge issue. It all started with Juul because they were basically marketing the young kids, and they got the ball rolling, and now we're still dealing with all the issues we have with vaping in our schools and with teenagers, students. Technically, by law, no one under the age of 21 is supposed to be able to buy a vaping product, but that's not happening. And it's sad to say that we have stores right here in our own community that are selling vapes to minor kids. And it is a huge issue. I know that there is some legislation that has been proposed, but I don't know exactly where that stands at. And now not only is it just the vaping in terms of the nicotine, it has went to the next level with THC. So this is all started with Juul, and we do have a settlement. Right now, only you guys can see that. Only the attorney can see that. At first, they wanted to say that this is a settlement that is confidential. Jonathan and I both talked, it is probably not something that's confidential. No. We're a public entity, so whenever we receive funds, the public has a right to know what those funds are. We have been advised, though, that if anybody does want to see the exact dollar amount, we would have to they would have to ask through a release of records to get that information. But I will tell you right now that it's less than $45,000. It's more than $40,000. So it's somewhere between that range without me giving you the exact amount. And again, if anybody wants to know exactly what it is, just do an open records request and we'll honor that. We're going to spend that money to help with the counseling that needs to take place with that. We've already spent money for vape detectors in our schools. Funny thing is once you spend money on vape detectors, they figure out how to get around it. But it has decreased vaping quite a bit in our schools. So we've already been out a lot of money. We've been out more than that just on the vape sensors in our schools. And Lord forbid if we have to move down into our fourth and fifth grade wings to do that. But now there is young kids that's preteens that are vaping. And so I hope that we can get a handle on that. But it is my recommendation to the board tonight that we accept that settlement and submit the proper paperwork. If y'all have any other questions, I'll be glad to try to answer them.
I need a motion to accept the paperwork and the litigation against Jewel Labs. Sheila Samples makes a motion. Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries.
And just so you'll know, that did not cost the board one red cent to be a part of that litigation, which moves us into the next one.
Okay, next we need to approve a resolution authorizing litigation against social media companies.
Well, we all know that social media companies has not caused us one issue within our schools, and I'll say that very lightly. But it's not just a fact of the bullying and harassment that takes place on social media, but what it has done is it has impacted the mental health of our students, especially coming out of the pandemic. And as you all know, we have used ESSER funds to hire additional counselors, to hire a social worker, to hire an LPCC, to handle these issues. And we have multiple agreements with different agencies to provide counseling for our kids, dealing with some of the mental health issues that has arisen from this. So I think it was pretty successful to join the first lawsuit against Jewel Labs, and it's my recommendation that we join this one as well and see where it takes us. Of course, if there's no settlement or there's no victory in the litigation, then there's no cost to the board to do so.
Okay. At this time, I'd like to ask for a motion to move forward and authorize litigation against the social media companies. Do I have a motion? Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Do I have a second? Sheila Samples makes a second. Do we have any discussion? I'd like to call for a vote at this time. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Next on our agenda, we need approval of an athletic training memorandum of agreement with Bluegrass Orthopedics.
You'll be happy to know that Bluegrass Orthopedics wants to continue their partnership with us, and not only do they want to continue, we are going to expand services, which means that Kirsten, we will have her, I believe now, 20 hours per week, and which is going to allow her to be able to not only just service, football and a few home games here and there, it's also going to allow her to travel during away football games. And, of course, soccer is a big need. And those 20 hours will be spent, with our athletic teams, and probably, like on Mondays, there'll be like some training appointments that can be made by our student athletes that do need to see that. So it's not full time, and Bluegrass Orthopedics worked really hard to try to get us to a full time status, but they also have to look at their bottom line as well. And $12,000 is this agreement, which that is a little bit more expensive than it was before. I think that doubles our previous fee, but it also probably triples the amount of time that we have Kirsten with us. So I do think that's a good move. They said they would continue to try to partner with us, and if there is a possibility in the future of moving to a full-time athletic training program, they will be glad to do it. But we're going to see how this goes to begin with and move on from there. So it's my recommendation that we approve this, and I do think it's a good move for all of our athletic programs.
So I need a motion to approve the athletic training MOA with Bluegrass Orthopedics for 20 hours a week, as discussed. Tammy Hardy makes a motion. Carrie Smallwood makes a second. Do we have any discussion? If not, I'd like to call for a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, it brings us down to our consent items. First of all, we have Mr. Saylor to review everything.
Yeah, the A and B's normal business. C, there are some surplus items. We're trying to clean out some different facilities, and so there are some surplus items that will be put up for bid. And we just had an employee that's asked for extended disability leave. Of course, that's leave without pay. We have reviewed the documentation for that and feel that it is acceptable.
Of course, it's one of those things you all have to approve it, but you're not really allowed to see all the paperwork. So it's my recommendation that we approve those consent items.
I need a motion to approve the consent items as discussed. Sheila Samples makes a motion. Do I have a second? Tammy Hardy makes a second. Do we have any discussion? If not, I'd like to call for a vote. All in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we are down to our superintendent's report.
Okay, you have your personnel actions that were attached. Donald has always given us an enrollment and attendance updates, and I know that we have started working with our schools to try to boost our attendance between now and the end of the school year. Of course, every tenth of a percentage point that we're able to raise our attendance will be a decrease in the amount of funding cuts that we'll face for the coming school year. So it's very important that we've started working on that. Here's good news in item C. As part of the memorandum of agreement with Bluegrass Orthopedic, they worked with us, and we have been able to get Apex Physical Therapy to partner with us in this project. And of course, what happens is that some of our students, if it's a real serious injury, of course, they will probably go to Bluegrass Orthopedics. They have a Saturday morning clinic for students that are injured over the weekend or on Friday night with football and different things. But Apex then could also provide some of the treatment, and that would all depend on Kerrison. Kerrison will help decide where what parents may need to do, and Apex has agreed to partner with us, and they're going to pay $6,000 of the $12,000 fee. So basically, we're in a Bluegrass is assuming a lot of responsibility. It cost them more than $12,000, but then Apex is going to pay $6,000 of that, which means the board will actually be out only $6,000 in this. And again, we'll see how that goes. And as that partnership grows, based on what kind of funding Apex is able to receive from treating their athletes, and then based on what Bluegrass is able to do, we may see it grow from there. But that is a good partnership, and I'm very appreciative of Stephen, who came by and saw us, and he sat down with us, Austin and I, and we're tickled to have them on board. you have your end of year dates. I sent those out to you all here the other day, and I think that's pretty much up to date. Biggest thing is that we have decided at South Irvin, and we didn't talk a lot about South Irvin on there, but I do think that May 12th, I believe, is the Friday that will be the last day for students at South Irvin, and they're going to have a couple of preschool registration days the following week. So other than that, those dates, I don't see anything a whole lot different. Graduation is set for Sunday, May 21st. Been a lot of discussion. Why are we graduating on Sunday afternoon? That is right during the middle of regional and district baseball and regional track, and it's in the middle of regional tennis. And we never want a student to have to decide whether or not they're going to participate in a regional track meet or they're going to participate in their graduation. There's one thing that you can guarantee on Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock. Originally, I think now we're going to move it to 3 o'clock because there was some concerns about some of our churches do let out a little bit later than 12:30, so we're going to move that to 3 o'clock. And so no student, no senior will have to decide whether or not they get to attend their graduation. The chamber is having a big after-school bash. That'll be down here on the Courthouse Square, I believe, on June 3rd for any of our students and families that want to participate. And then, of course, I've got June 23rd on there for the Urban Memorial Park and Estill Springs Elementary dedication. You have some fundraiser reports there. Also, item F, I know will be of interest to you. As you all know, we had Mr. Puckett that came and talked to us the other day about selling a piece of property. You have an email from Ross Tarrant. that basically explains the piece of property that he is interested in. It sits right above where a proposed site for a new middle school would be in terms of not only just the building itself, but also with the athletic facilities that would go along with that building, because if you build a new middle school, you'll want to build baseball and softball fields, because now you know it's an issue because they're sharing. You'll want to build a grass football field. I mean, so you'll want to build those facilities and have middle school facilities just like, you know, every other middle school that we compete against. So there were concerns about drainage, and there would have to be some earthwork done there, and that cut on that property would go back so far, and how far it would have to go back, it's yet undetermined until you decide exactly where that school's at. And of course, with the report that we got today, that makes it a real possibility now that the school district will need to build a middle school sometime in the mid-2030s. I just do not, it's not my recommendation that we sell that property. We know how hard we had to work to find a piece of property, and I sure don't think we need to be selling off that piece of property now, knowing that there is a need for that property within the next 15 years. I did speak with him today. He understands completely. I did not want him to hear it tonight for the first time, so I called him, and he and I spoke this morning for probably about 10 minutes or so. So he understands, and he's appreciative of your consideration, but he does understand the need of the school district. Last item, real quick, is as much as I hate to even ask you all this, I really thought our legislature would try to help with the fact that we're coming off a pandemic, with the fact that our attendance is lower, with the fact that we have more students on homeschool. Thank God we're not like everybody else, because I know that Mr. Norton has worked his rear end off to try to get our homeschool students back in the fold. But regardless of that, this school district, without legislative action, and they've got to probably 12, they have the 12 o'clock tonight to do something, so they're not going to do anything, I can tell you right now. This school district is facing about a $900,000 cut in seat funds for next school year. Now, it'd be easy for me to walk out of here and say, let the next administration handle that, but that's not the way I operate, and you all know that. We need to have a budget work session to seriously consider what we need to do. The other thing that's being laid out there, again, is being laid at our feet. Again, is whether or not you even consider employee raises. I do think there is some possibilities there, but it's going to take some consideration in terms of what, but they would be minimal at best. So with those two issues in mind, I really think we need to have a special called board meeting. And if we can have it somewhere either around April 11th, which is a Tuesday night, or April 13th, which is Thursday night, before the board meeting on the 20th, that will give me plenty of time to bring back to you district staffing policies, possibly even bring you the district salary schedule for next school year. We have to have both of those items in place in plenty of time.
If we did the 11th, that'd give you a little bit more time.
11th gives us a little bit more. I'm free either night. I mean,
I say the 11th.
I say the 11th.
Everybody good with that? 6 o'clock would be, I would think that an hour and a half would be plenty of time. I would not anticipate us being here past 7:30. We probably can even get it done in an hour. I've already been exploring this. I mean, I knew the possibility was coming. I've already looked at some different things that we can do by using some of our ESSER funds, eliminating some positions due to attrition, by making some financial moves in terms of using some of our capital outlay cash that we have possibly to purchase school buses. I've already looked at things that could save the district somewhere between $1 to $1.2 million without a loss of jobs and without somebody losing jobs. The only situation you would have with any employees would be, it's not going to be, there's not going to be because of job cuts. If there's any loss of jobs, it would be because of doing what's right for kids. And I'll leave it at that. That's the safest way to say it. So if you all are good with April 11th, we'll set that at 6 o'clock. And that is it for superintendent report. And I'm sorry for being so long.
Okay. Next on our agenda, we have our board member forum. Do we have anything to report from our board?
No, we had a very successful, informative KSBA conference.
The jazz band was fantastic.
They represented Estill and Ewing County well. And people wanted to hear them instead of going to their sessions. Can we just listen to them instead, is what we heard several times. Yeah. And I'd like to ask for a moment of silence. Paul Hughes' wife, Joanne, passed away this morning. He's one of our former high school principals when I went to school. And his daughter, one of them taught here, and also worked at central office, Ann. So if we could have a moment of silence for that family. Okay.
So at this time, we'd like to have a moment of silence for Mr. Paul Hughes' wife, Joanne, and their families at this time.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Do we have any public comments, Mr. Willis? At this time, I'd like to call for an adjournment. Need a motion to adjourn by Tammy Hardy, second by Sheila Samples. This meeting is adjourned at this time. 7:21.
Thank you, everybody.
Mr. Sutton, I was asked, are there going to be any music positions open possibly? I know this is redundant, asking after we talked about.
We have posted a middle school band position.
Okay.
As far as I know right now, that's the only one that I know of. I don't anticipate either one of our music teachers at the elementary schools leaving.
Okay.
Or at least we've not been told anything.
What's up?
Okay, you all do know we have a special call board meeting on the 28th.
Mr. Britton? 28th.
He is leaving education for a while. His parents are not doing well.
Oh.
And he has just said that he.
Thank you.
I've left it open as long as I could.